through the carbonate, that's how I got free. Jabba back off because there's no stopping me. Postmodern player, sample-tastic, flows ekphrastic, I get drastic. Hey, watch the plastic, yo, I name check and leave you drastic.
Welcome to the MacGuffin, episode 226. I'm Spencer.
I'm Greg.
Today, in honor of the release of Warm Bodies, mm-hmm. we're going to be talking zombie movies.
Yeah. Long time coming, I feel.
Okay. We got to get a few caveats out of the way.
Yes.
Number one, zombie film we're going to use in general sense. Because, I mean, I'm sure you could technically get on us that maybe some of these are a virus and not really zombies or something like that. So we'll throw that out of the way. Mm-hmm. Number two, we're not trying to be a definitive history of zombies here. Yeah. We're just talking about zombie films that are meaningful to us.
Yeah.
And have been noteworthy mm-hmm. in some capacity. We're not trying to be like, this zombie film led to this zombie film led to this zombie. We're
This isn't a top.
Yes. I'm sure there are much more expert zombie aficionados out there.
That zombologists.
Could, that can school us about this. So don't get on us about that. But if you want to fill in some of those details in the comments or something, that'd be cool.
Yeah.
I take that. But, you know, don't expect this to be the, like, Bible of zombie stories.
Yes, this is a brief glimpse into zombie films that have affected the MacGuffin podcast. Yeah.
So with that being said, let's get started. Probably the first real noteworthy one. There might have been some before this, and I'm not going to argue.
Mostly foreign or old.
I'm not going to argue that, but the one that sort of brought it to prominence, and that's Night of the Living Dead.
Yes.
Firstly, we're going to get off the note that they don't actually call them zombies in this movie.
They call them usually those things, as if anything that they're
described. And it's said they're living dead.
Yes.
I mean, zombie was a term that sort of came into popular consciousness later.
But Romero, who did this film, pretty much kept that movie out of almost every project he did. Yeah. I mean, that term, the term zombie, out of almost every project he did.
Until he became, like, totally into...
Pretty much.
So, I mean, you know, in terms of the film, it's kind of an interesting... I mean, it's definitely a very indie film.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very interesting sort of film. Like, I think this is one of the more conceptually interesting zombie films to me because of how it's handled, and sort of like, what if you were in a world and suddenly dead people just started like attacking everywhere and you didn't know what was going on, and it's everywhere you look there's dead people. And I think that's a really interesting idea.
Oh yeah, I mean, there's a reason that it has become such a popular, like, not trope, I guess, maybe story element of zombies and living undead.
I mean, this is much more of the sort of classic zombies, too. I mean, they're slow. They're not really, like...
they're not smart in any way.
No, like, it's very much like a drone-type feel to them. And, you know, it's interesting because, you know, it doesn't really... I don't know how bleak you want to call this story. I mean...
Very.
It's obviously gone on to do many other films. But it does capture sort of a fear. And I would say creating one of the new sort of monsters for the first time in a long time. I mean, you know, you've had your, like, Draculas. I guess you could argue Frankenstein is sort of in the same sort of vein. But,
somewhat.
I mean, if you think about all the history of monsters in America, or in the world, I guess you would say. I mean, a lot of them were either predating film or made famous during the early days of film.
Yes.
And this was one of the first ones to be added to that lineage that's gone on to become a really significant player in the monster hierarchy, especially nowadays. I mean, this and vampires are probably the two main ones going at this point.
There's just something about that, like, turning, you know, what was once humans into the other. You know, it's not something that's not human. It was human. It was, you know, your family member,
That's just it. I mean, I think there's an element, you know, if you're killing a vampire or something like that, you know, you're killing a monster. But this, like, there's an element of, like, you know, do you have to kill... Is this my wife?
Yeah,
killing my wife or my mom or whatever. Like, you're killing somebody who means something to you, and you don't want to kill them. You believe they could be cured or something like that. And there's also something scary about, like, if the dead don't stay dead.
Yeah.
Like, that's, I mean, essentially an unstoppable force.
And what's even scarier, if we think about some of the, like, zombie tropes that we think about now, and we think of them as, like, being well-established and kind of always present. But a lot of them, I mean, there's been older films that have probably done these, but, like, this movie is one of the ones that popularized the ideas that the living dead or zombies actually would eat the dead bodies or eat each other, because when they decided to base the film on zombies, the crew brainstormed about what would be the most shocking thing that they thought zombies would do to people, and they decided that cannibalism would be like that farthest they could go in that. And that's now like just completely assumed that zombies don't just want to kill you because you're alive or a brainless creature, but they specifically want to kill you for a food source. And that's also much scarier, a brainless animal that used to be a human. Like,
yeah, that's scary. It's sort of interesting thing about this film, because of due to errors with the copyrights, it's now in the public domain.
Yeah, they didn't know that you had to put copyrights and stuff, or you had to put stuff up saying that you owned it, and so it was. It went, I think, in '89 is when it hit public domain.
I know it's on like YouTube and stuff.
And most of the money went to distributors. Romero didn't make very much because of that same reason. Didn't have the rights to say, "Give me all the money."
Did make it into the National Film Preservation Board.
Yep.
Into the film registry.
Probably because of public domain. It's like, hey, let's grab it.
I'm sure it's also because of its historical
relevance,
significance.
I know. I just like tossing that out
there.
Yeah,
that's good.
They're coming to get you, Barbara.
Yeah. Moving right along to another significant film in the history of zombies,
the
if you will.
Evolution of zombies.
Yeah, and this is The Return of the Living Dead. This is directed by Dan O'Bannon, who was one of the co-writers of the screenplay. You might not know of him because this is the only other film he directed was a film called Shatterbrain in '91. But his real most important significant role, this if you could argue this or that, but he also was one of the writers of Alien.
Oh wow!
So
he—that's right. That's where
he was involved with all the characters and stuff like that. So I mean, he's one of those guys, sort of in the same vein as Fred Decker, from Night of the Creeps and stuff like that, who is a very talented writer and director, but really got limited chances. And sadly, he's dead. Fred Decker, I believe, is still alive, but Dan O'Bannon's dead, and so he's not going to get any more chances.
Yeah.
But like, a very, very talented guy, and he sort of took the concept of Night of the Living Dead and ran with that, and sort of took it and created. Took zombies to the next level, not just like dead that were coming back to life, but also like, you know, they try and kill these zombies and it creates like, I don't know what you want, like an acid rain, but that sort of turns people into zombies.
Yes.
The gas created by the burning of the zombies turns people into them. And
it starts to spread more than just through being killed by a zombie.
But also, like, he sort of popularized the concept of brains. Like, this is the one where the zombie started specifically, you know, brains, going for brains and stuff like that. And, you know, it's, I would say it's a much more sort of, I don't know.
Almost comedic? No.
Yeah, I mean, there's sort of that. Goofy. There's much more sort
Leslie
of a
Nielsen
punk.
Was supposed to be in it at one point, originally, if that tells you anything.
I would say it's more sort of a, like a punk-ish kind of approach to it, like whereas the original was more sort of just like you don't know what's going on, like this one you a gang of punks essentially is the one stuck at the heart of the zombie attack, and you know, so it's a group of like more, I don't know if you want to call them related
alternative,
I don't know if you want to call them relatable individuals, like, you know, the original, like, they're just general people.
Yeah.
But this is people who I would say were more sort of relatable to the general populace
because it
played to the sort of more of a youthful audience. I mean, I don't know. Maybe I wasn't around when the original came out, so I can't say that truly. But this one feels like, you know, this is the same time as like the Sex Pistols and stuff like that are coming out and being popular. So it's much more of sort of a popular topic at the time. So it took something that was sort of an intriguing idea and turned it into sort of a pop culture icon.
Interesting that, you know, because probably of the copyright problems, that it's got Living Dead in the title, which was, I mean, they wanted them to change it because the similarity to Romero, but they didn't have to legally. They didn't win that. Romero's people didn't win that fight legally.
Yeah. I mean, there's stuff continued on, you know, of like the dead turning or the zombies turning other people into zombies, but like, unlike the other one, this is a gas driven one. So again, you know, zombies have had much more of a nebulous sort of
origin.
There's a lot of different sort of origins to zombies, and this sort of just adds yet another addition to that chapter. It's an entertaining film, you know. Got some very interesting people in it, like Jewel Shepherd, who, if you ever seen our MacGuffin interview with Jill Shepard.
Oh, that's right, yes.
She was one of the individuals in this movie. So, yeah.
I think it's interesting that unlike a lot of zombie films out there, or movies just about the undead or living dead, they actually say zombie in this film.
Mm-hmm.
They full-on use that word. It's actually said when Tom Matthews' character Freddy is discussing with Frank in the office about how the movie Night of the Living Dead, entertainingly, they're talking about their source material, couldn't have possibly been based on a true case since it depicted zombies taking over the world. So,
well, I do kind of feel bad for Romero. I mean, it's an entertaining film, but I do feel bad for him in the sense that, like, A, they took Of the Dead
yes.
and used that to make money,
mm-hmm.
but they also then reference yeah. it in the movie as sort yeah. of like a double fuck you. So,
exactly.
Like,
hey, we know that there was Night of the Living Dead.
What are you going to do? What are you going to do? You can't do nothing exactly. to us. So, yep. yeah, it's sort of like, that's a shame. Continuing on sort of the evolution of the zombie.
Yes.
Genre, if you will,
yes.
is 28 Days Later.
Yes.
This is the Danny Boyle directed story about the rage virus mm-hmm. that spreads throughout the world and turns people into what you would describe as zombies.
Yes.
And
Edward.
Yeah. Starring Cillian Murphy, mm-hmm. who plays a man who has sort of a very Walking Dead-esque moment where he wakes up in a hospital and everyone's gone and
yeah.
everyone or dead or whatever, and he's just trying to figure out what's going on around him.
Danny Boyle did a lot, made a lot of like deals and worked very hard with the London government to be allowed to film in certain times when they would hold off traffic or not let traffic through. But it was a constant fight. Like a lot of the places, like that hospital he wakes up in, is an actual hospital that they evacuated. Hmm. Like when he goes through like when they go through that tunnel, that was like a tunnel specifically that they got access to use.
Those are some of the most memorable scenes in the movie mm-hmm. because it's just like, wow, these are.
It's not a CGI version of London. It's actual London, empty.
Which like, is it's so weird to see a big city completely desolated.
It's very
or empty.
Creepy. And you know, as you said before, like this is one of those ones that oftentimes gets argued about being a zombie mm-hmm. movie or not. Danny Boyle specifically wanted to change a lot of the things that had been done with normal zombie movies to this, which is why it's sometimes not argued not to be one, because it's more of a virus and things like that.
I mean, much sort of like, you know, Return of the Living Dead, it's not just like dead people come back to life. There's an instigator or whatever you want to call
Rage
it.
Rage was based on Ebola, interestingly enough, which is communicable in all primates and is transmitted through the blood. Bill is a hemorrhagic fever, which leads to a rash, red eyes, and both internal and external bleeding.
I think you start bleeding. Like bleeding from all your orifices.
And then I guess there was a graphic novel called 28 Days Later, The Aftermath, which was supposed to take place between 28 weeks later, that explained that Ebola was being used by scientists as a carrier for the inhibitor, which mutated into Rage. So they even make at one point part of their like backstory that Ebola is relevant to it. So
one of the other interesting things that he brought to this, and then I guess it was more sort of typified with the remake of Dawn mm-hmm. of the Dead, was the fast zombie.
Oh yeah.
Like technically Dawn of the Dead, I feel like gets a lot of the notoriety for the fast mm-hmm. zombie, but this actually came out 2 years before that, and this had fast zombies as well. So in addition to, you know, adding like brains to the mm-hmm. history, now we've got fast moving zombies, which I think is largely displaced slow moving zombies for the most part.
I mean, that's the thing, is like it's always been, no matter how scary zombies have been, the one thing that we've always had, other than they're not intelligent, is that we can move faster than them. That's like the one.
That's the getaway.
That's the one holdup of how man can live.
That's the whole, like, if you hit them in the head, you kill them.
Yeah, but that still involves like interacting with them. I'm talking about people who, like, your average person who is being has a problem with zombies. As long as you have somewhere to go, that you can usually get away. I think it's interesting that. One of the things they also brought up was that the difference with the Rage virus beyond fast zombies, which, by the way, Danny Boyle got real-life professional athletes to play all the zombie roles.
Wow.
So that what they did would be really athletic and really, like, prime
scary,
situation.
Yeah.
But one of the things that they did that was more contemporary was the idea that the virus didn't necessarily affect people physically. Like, it doesn't kill them like it does in traditional zombie movies, but psychologically. And they say both Alec Garland and Danny Boyle felt that the idea of a virus that renders people zombie-like due to uncontrollable rage was a good metaphor for the contemporary phenomena of social rage, such as road rage, air rage, hospital rage, etc. They like the idea that the virus simply amplifies something already in each and every other man and woman, rather than turning them into something entirely other, as they normally do.
Does technically zombie serve as a general term for somebody who's not really in control of themselves?
Yeah, somewhat brainless.
But, like, it's because of the movies, it's become associated with the undead.
Yes.
So it's...
I mean, original zombies comes from voodoo, and that's not undead. Yeah, it's controlling someone's mind and making them your slave.
Whether you look at it as being a true zombie film or not, like, in the generalist sense of what zombie means, it's still a zombie movie.
Exactly. So it still has that whole mentality of what a zombie... I mean, even if it's not a zombie movie, it's essentially a zombie scenario that plays out, so...
Sure. And it's, you gotta give a lot of credit to Boyle and Killian Murphy. I mean, they were nominated for a whole slew of British Independent Film Awards. they lost the best British independent film to Dirty Pretty Things, lost director to Stephen Frears for Dirty Little Things, which, you think back now, which film is really the more noteworthy one?
Back to 2020.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. also, Empire Awards, it won Best British Film. And Killian Murphy was nominated for Best Newcomer, but lost to Rosamund Pike for Die Another Day. Again, 2020, we're going to look back on that and be like, what were you thinking?
Yeah.
Clearly, Killian Murphy's the one to take away.
Yeah.
And he was also nominated for Breakthrough Male Performance for the MTV Movie Awards, but he lost to Martin McCutcheon for Love Actually. Again, 2020, I think people are going to look back and be like, Killian Murphy, 28 days later.
How did we not do?
I'm not even going into that. But one of the other interesting things that we haven't really gone into with the zombie genre,
specifically considering the reason we're talking, the movie that we're talking about,
is that it's really one of the most open genres in terms of not just being horrific movies. Mm-hmm. Like, it also has comedy, a lot of comedy, in fact, most recently in the last decade.
Yes,
And we're going to start by talking about Shaun of the Dead, which was one of the most noteworthy comedic takes on it.
Of course, the Edgar Wright directed, Simon Pegg and Nick Frost starring, first of the, I forget what they call the trilogy.
The End of the World trilogy.
Yes.
And it's about a couple of guys and their girlfriends and whatnot who are... just happen to be at the point where the world is ending by zombies rising up. And, it's a very funny film. Let's get that out of the way. But the thing that I think is most interesting about it is that they sort of took the idea of being in a zombie world and made it funny. Like, just that notion is a very foreign idea. Mm-hmm. Like, it's sort of being like, oh, we're going to make Friday the 13th, except, Jason's going to be hunting them, but it's going to be really funny.
Yeah.
And so,
hunting with pies.
Yeah, it's sort of like, there is this element of death constantly hovering over them. And there are people who die in the movie.
Oh, yeah.
People who matter to them, mothers and friends and whatnot. But they still are able to keep it a very light movie for the most part.
It's because Saturday night is the night for fighting, Spencer.
Yeah. It's, have you seen Spaced?
Oh, yeah.
Before this came out?
No, not before this came out, no.
So those are sort of my first exposure to Edgar Wright, Simon Pegg, and Nick Frost, who had previously done a TV show called Spaced.
Yes, and most of the cast from Spaced is in there.
Some capacity, And I hadn't seen that until after this. And so this is my first exposure, and I was like, oh, I remember seeing this in the theater. And people being like, I think I read about it online or something, saying it was funny. So I was like, all right, I'll go check it out. And I died. Like,
oh, yeah. I don't think anyone was expecting a zombie comedy to be not just funny, but so funny.
I don't know how you perceive, a zombie comedy. As I said, a funny vampire movie.
Exactly.
Without being sort of like... like a Seltzer Brother or whatever, like an airplane-y type.
Yeah,
sort of,
like spoof lampooning almost.
Sort of something like that. And this is not that.
No,
like, this
it's not a parody. This is very much an homage.
This treats zombies with respect. Like, they're still a dangerous entity.
And just Edgar Wright is so meticulous, like Quentin Tarantino is, with his referencing the things that inspired him and the source material. Like, this movie contains so many references to so many things. I couldn't possibly list them all, They even say, we're coming to get you, Barbara. They say, don't say the Z word, which is, all these things are really intrinsic in the movie. But one that I somehow have never noticed, but now makes me want to watch the entire film again, is almost every bit part character that shows up in the film comes back later as a zombie.
I think I generally remember that,
like,
yeah.
Even to the smallest extent, like, yeah. People that aren't even in the same situation that are just later seen in, like, crowd shots that were bit parts that, like, walked by.
You also sort of see that element of, like, people reliving their lives as zombies, like, you know, where he goes through his life, his daily routine, mm-hmm. and everyone who's, like, you know, like, a store owner is, mm-hmm. like, a zombie store owner. So you see a lot of that sort of stuff played out as well. So.
Yeah, I just love that fact that they did that.
I also think it's interesting to sort of see this is, like, one of the first times you see a relationship transcend a zombie zombification or whatever, mm-hmm. where Nick Frost and Simon Pegg are still friends, even though Nick Frost is a zombie at the
Well, that's one of the things in general this movie basically implies at the end is not that we stop zombies or that we wipe them all out, but that we basically acclimate it into our daily life. There's like zombie reality television, yeah. and like zombie daytime shows, yeah. and you know, and so he's got a zombie friend.
My husband is a mm-hmm. zombie, stuff yeah. like that, yeah.
I also think it's interesting that, especially after the popularity of something like 28 Days Later to have come up before and have changed the game so much, for this game changer to be not only just a game changer in the sense of being a comedy, but going back to slow-moving zombies even. Mm-hmm. And Simon Pegg was asked why they went with slow zombies instead of fast zombies, and he said, quote, because death is not an energy drink.
Respect that. I mean, it worked for the movie. They were able to do it perfectly. So totally. I'm totally in. It won the Empire Award for Best British Film.
Deserved.
Well deserved.
Amazing. Yeah. Amazing film.
Sadly, lost the BAFTA to My Summer of Love, which, again, you know, 2020 awards, we'll be looking back on this one, shaking that finger.
Mm-hmm.
Continuing right along, though, another one that I guess, I mean, you could argue zombie, virus, whatever you want to call it, and that's Wreck.
Yes.
Which has since gone on to be remade in America as Quarantine.
Yeah, with what's her name from Dexter? Sister?
Carpenter.
Yeah.
Is it Jessica Carpenter? I don't remember. Yes, the sister from Dexter, whatever. Mm-hmm. it's about a reporter who goes to a firehouse, who gets trapped in a building that is then quarantined.
Yes, and
she can't get in
and out. Something else inside. Yes.
And zombies, or whatever you want to call them, start to sort of pick everyone off one by one. And it's probably one of my favorite. It's originally a Spanish film from director Juan, was it Jaume Balergo?
Sure. Balaguero. Let's go with that. We're not Spanish, I'm sorry.
Yeah. I'm going to go Jaume.
Okay.
Balergo. And it's, I mean, it's one of the creepiest films I've seen in the zombie genre. Not just because the way they pace it is very suspenseful, but also the idea of being trapped in an area.
Because as we just said, what's the one advantage we always have against zombies? Outthink them, get away. If you can't see them and you can't get away, you're fucked.
But they're also, they're not slow ones necessarily.
Yes.
But it's also the fact that you're trapped. Like, it's sort of like being trapped in the house with a killer or something like that. But in this case, it's a zombie.
Yes.
And it is really an unnerving idea. And there's sort of an element of, like,
definitely unnerving.
Bigger picture sort of thing, where it's sort of like the outside world may or may not have information that you don't know. As you sort of get glimpses of what's going on outside and sort of, like, their plans for what they're going to do with the building. And there's sort of an element of, like, you're trying to figure out what's going on.
Yes.
It's sort of a mystery slash zombie film in one. Whereas, you know, a lot of the time with zombie movies, you're not trying to figure out what's going on. Nobody's like,
there's no, it's usually just suspense. There's not much actual element.
You're not trying to figure out why everyone's a zombie, how the dead came back to life. That's not a trope.
No.
So this takes that and adds sort of an element of, like, I don't know what you would call it, a mystery thriller sort of to it. And it's sort of a zombie thriller. And it's very good. It's very good.
I think it's amazing that, I mean, the director really wanted to capture this sense of trapped and scared. And so the actors were never given the script in its entirety, so that none of them knew their characters' fates, sometimes not until the day they were actually filming the scenes. This meant that actors were, more often than not, stressed, nervous, and apprehensive on the day of filming, ideal qualities for what they wanted to be showing, because they would never know, so you'd always be acting like you were a main character. And the other thing, going along that same line, the closing passages of the films were actually shot in complete darkness with an infrared camera.
Yeah.
So the actors had no idea what was going on around them.
Well, that, I mean, that's, I mean, I don't know, if it's probably not the first time it's been used, but like, as you, I mean, if you've seen Quarantine, it's essentially the same ending where you have like the flash going off and sort of like you're looking flash. You're sort
small of, glimpses of still single stills and blackness.
Yeah, and there's there may or may not be something in the room with you. It's it's so unnerving. It's definitely one of those incredibly tense scenes that you just know is not going to go well. You know it, so.
Humanity always has a fear of the dark, and when you know that there's something there, that doesn't help.
Unfortunately, this series has sort of been going more the route of like Resident Evil and just pumping out the sequels, but you know,
But let's stick with the story, with the original here.
Let's keep it pleasant. Not to be outdone in terms of the zombie comedy realm, we also have Zombieland. This is from Ruben Fleischer, who just released Gangster Squad.
Yes.
This is his take on the... the zombie comedy genre.
Interestingly enough, originally supposed to be a television series.
Which still may happen, actually.
Yeah, they're actually thinking of now turning it back into
Well, they talked about doing a sequel, and it looks like the sequel is now out, and they're talking about resurrecting the...
I see what you did there.
The show.
Bringing it back from the dead.
Yeah, exactly. it's the story of, it's...
Survivors.
Well, it sort of takes the idea of like Shaun of the Dead, where, you know, this thing has occurred and takes it like, you know, I don't know, years in the future or whatever, where people are living in this world of zombies. Like, it's occurred. This is like a given. It's not like it's happening. There are flashbacks to sort of the beginning of it.
Yes.
But for the most part, this is just like...
These are the people that have survived after the initial wave of everyone finding out the zombies exist.
Like, so they're not dealing with like, oh my God, zombies. It's just like, okay, we've got zombies around. Let's deal with life day to day. And this is one of the, I would say, breakout performances of Jesse Eisenberg as he plays the lead character.
Ohio, I forget. Columbus, that's right.
Who is sort of a quirky dude with a lot of rules to survive in zombie land, as he calls it. These rules have helped him survive up to now.
And yes.
He sort of befriends a group of characters along his travels within said zombie land.
Tallahassee, played by Woody Harrelson.
Yep. Wichita, Emma Stone, Little Rock, Abigail Breslin.
I find it entertaining that that Woody Harrelson's a vegan and Twinkies aren't. So even though he was hugely into it, they actually replaced the Twinkies with like cornmeal or something for him to simulate the eating them, because after all that drive, he wouldn't eat them. So the actor. It's also interesting to note that you can see some elements of the movie that when you think about it as a television show kind of makes sense. Like, for example, the zombie kill of the week.
Yeah.
That was supposed to be a thing on each episode. It was that's an actual straight up carryover from the television pilot that they had originally planned on making. So each week it was going to have different characters.
Also, I mean,
in a different way.
You know, not to get into what we're going to go to next, but there's an element of it about, you know, it's less about the zombies and more about the people. It's sort of about more of a survival story than dealing with a zombie story.
Yes.
Like, that's just something that pops up every so often. And so you can very much see, like, in the interactions, the friendship between Jesse Eisenberg and Woody Harrelson, and then later with Emma Stone and Abigail Breslin, you know, how these friendships and sort of like love interests or whatever you want to go into sort of evolve. It's sort of that is much more sort of the driving force in the movie than the actual zombies themselves. Like, there's not like one zombie that's constantly chasing them or something like that.
I think it's interesting that this series really drives home the idea that that essentially what causes you to be to lose against the zombies is a lack of being prepared for it, and that's essentially kind of implied in the show as the reason why everything went bad, because Columbus has his rules that he strictly follows, and those are what has kept him and those around him to survive for so long, is because they understand enough to know that they need to, like, outrun him and, like, not to go in these certain situations that always go bad, like, things like that. It's much more about the adapting to it that's happened. I also think it's really weird, like, the circular weird nature of Hollywood, that the term Zombieland was originally coined by Robert Downey Jr. in Natural Born Killers.
Interesting.
Yep, when he was talking about television audiences, which it was supposed to be a television show.
Hey now.
Meta. And he starred it with Woody Harrelson. Okay.
I will say that it also is one of the best cameos, probably of all time, with Bill Murray.
Yep.
So funny.
I forget who. It was originally supposed to be someone else that was that. I should have written it down. It was a different celebrity that was supposed to be that, but then couldn't do it for...
Bill Murray, probably the funniest thing he'd done in, I don't know, 10 years or something like that.
So good.
Sadly, this film was largely shut down in terms of awards. I mean, it was nominated for Broadcast Film Critics Award for Best Comedy, Lost to the Hangover. It was nominated for a few Teen Choice Awards for Breakout Male for Jesse Eisenberg, who lost to Liam Hemsworth for The Last Song. I mean, that is a snub if I've heard one. And Emma Stone lost for Best Comedy Actress to Tina Fey for Date Night, which...
Of all the things to give Tina Fey, Date Night is not the one you should be giving her.
And it's not even a bad movie, but really, she's not as interesting as Emma Stone. And also, Empire Awards, it lost Best Horror Film to Let the Right One In, which...
Okay, fair enough.
Probably the most legitimate one, but it's weird to describe it as a horror film.
It's true.
I mean, because as zombies, I guess technically it's a horror film, but that's not at all what I would describe it as.
Last little bit of trivia. Counting for not worrying about inflation, it is the highest grossing domestic film that starts with a Z.
Interesting.
Probably not that many out there, which
about
is probably
$100 million.
Yeah.
Probably the only one.
Yeah.
That's interesting. Moving right along, probably the most obvious one, or one of the most obvious ones we had to talk about on this list, and that is The Walking Dead.
Yep.
This is the TV series on AMC about, again, a group of survivors dealing with the aftermath of a zombie apocalypse, if you will.
Yes.
Unfortunately, unlike Zombieland, this takes a much more horrific approach to it, where it's fighting for survival.
Yes,
really.
This is much more the 28 days later, minus the rage, but I mean in the, like, setup of, like, a world that's already screwed.
Sort of think of main it as character, like, The Road.
Yeah, I can see that. Main character waking up in a hospital and everything's already happened and he doesn't know about it. Such an interesting series that has gone through so many weird production hiccups and show changes. Forerunner changes.
Yeah,
that it's just...
I mean, it was originally done by Frank Darabont, who did Shawshank Redemption.
Yep.
Unfortunately, after a successful first season, he was, I don't know what you want to believe, he was pushed out or he decided to leave. I mean, he was then
shit-canned.
He was then out. Fortunately, it took sort of a drop off the second season.
But thank God the third season leaped right back into the first season glory, in my opinion.
Obviously, this film, or maybe it's not obvious, I don't know, it's based on a well-known graphic novel series, though it's sort of...
Robert Kirkman.
Sort of diverged from that series, and, you know, changes have been made for the people who read the series, and additional changes have been made in regards to things that Robert Kirkman would have changed in retrospect. Like, in the graphic novel series, one of the main characters' hand gets cut off pretty early on.
Yes.
And in retrospect, he's like, I know I wouldn't have done that. That kind of creates a lot of problems.
And stuff like the Daryl Dixon, Norman Reedus' character. The Dixon brothers didn't exist in the original comic. And I think Robert Kirkman said after the first season was done, if there was one thing in retrospect he could change the most, it would have been to make Daryl a main character from, like, the get-go. He would have been, like, one of the original, because he loves Daryl Dixon.
And so many people love him.
Daryl Dixon is loved so much that the Walking Dead video games, I don't know if you've heard about these that have been
I've heard of them.
There are multiple episodes, are a prequel story of Daryl Dixon and Al Rooker's character, I forget the other brother, Merle Dixon.
Oh.
The two of them traveling through Atlanta.
Michael Rooker.
Al Rooker? What am I saying?
So you're talking about the Weatherman? Weird. I was like, the Weatherman?
Al Rooker? Michael Rooker? Wow.
Woo!
But yeah, the video game series involves Norman Reedus and Michael Rooker's characters traveling through Atlanta in the time that Rick would have been in his coma.
Interesting.
And even voiced by Norman Reedus. It's very, very, very popular, and the series has come out in installments and let you make decisions that would affect the way the story goes on forever. Really, really fascinating stuff. But
yeah, I mean, it's definitely an engaging idea. I think, you know, zombie apocalypse is, I mean, I guess any apocalypse, you could argue this, is a very conducive concept to being a television series because it's an ongoing...
Yes, and it's very conducive to drama.
It's just like, you think about something like, you know, with the exception of maybe Shaun of the Dead and perhaps 28 Days Later, pretty much all these just end.
Yes.
Like, there's no, like, this is how things turned out. Like, you know, most of the time you're just like, this
most
is the end of the story.
Most of the time there isn't much of an epilogue of
like
the
it's
world.
Just, it's just like, this is the point at which we're going to end our storytelling, but it's not like the world has corrected itself.
Yes.
So this really is very much continue on that, like, you know, they might survive one episode, they might survive two, but the problems are still
there. Yeah,
this
problem is still there. I think it's interesting that the word, you know, again, one of those things that the word zombie is never said throughout the whole first season. Zombies are either usually referred to as walkers, geeks, roamers, lame brains, test subjects. In season two, they're called biters and lurkers. Like, it's another one of those things where it's just more about, like, how people would react to what they're doing than identifying them with some pop culture thing that had existed. I also think it's just something that I appreciate the makeup and special effects department of this show.
Yeah, it's very well done. Amongst the best I've ever seen, actually.
Yeah, and they, I mean, like, everybody who plays zombie goes to, like, a zombie school, and, like, the zombie cast all eat and get their makeup and everything done in a separate location than the normal cast so that there's no intermingling, so that there's this very
shock,
distance to them. And also, just interestingly enough, in season three, the makeup team used darker skin tones for all of the walkers to show that further decay had happened as time had progressed. Like, I like that they're
That's
paying
smart,
attention
yeah.
to that kind of thing with something like a television show that you're going to have to worry about, like, this is going to go on in time. We got to think about these things that in, like, a movie you wouldn't have to worry about. You wouldn't have to worry about, like, showing a major progression of time if you didn't want to. But the show is clearly going to progress on, and things are going to happen. So,
interesting.
Mm-hmm. Ongoing comic series, too. Yeah. So, yeah. still going.
That brings us to this Friday, February 1st, the release of Warm Bodies. This is the story of...
Zom rom-com?
Yeah, a Zom rom-com, a zombie rom-comedy about a young zombie played by Nicholas Holt from About a Boy, who we'll probably talk about more because he's blowing up with Jack the Giant Slayer and the new Mad Max movie coming out. Playing a character named R, who comes across a living girl. And, I mean, the film sort of is told from his perspective based on a book by Isaac Marion, who's actually a local Seattleite.
Wow, nice. There you go, Isaac.
And who's going to be in an interview on this very podcast
by
the time this
guys.
Comes out.
You see what we do for you.
But he sort of...
And by we, I mean Spencer.
Yeah. it's told from the perspective of R, who is a zombie, sort of as he goes through his day, you know, living his life, sort of like he can't remember who he was before he became a zombie, how he, like, tries to interact with people, but all he can do is grunt and stuff like that. It's a very funny movie, and... after accident, I don't know, killing this woman's boyfriend, they eat the brains because they inherit the memories of the characters, and that's why they eat the brains. And so he sort of falls for her because of her boyfriend's memories.
Naturally.
And through their relationship, there sort of sees a way out of the zombie apocalypse.
Interesting.
It's a really surprisingly entertaining film. I really... do recommend checking
it
out.
Seen it already?
I have seen it already.
Son of a bitch.
it's really, you go into it not knowing how it's going to play out as a zombie comedy, and it's very funny, it's very kind of sweet, and there's some great supporting work, like Rob Corddry's in it as a supporting zombie, and it's probably one of the best Rob Corddry roles I've ever seen. Like, he's...
Wow.
Sweet, he's funny, and he's not over the top. Like,
wow.
it's
usually almost every role he plays, he's over the top.
Yeah, it's really, I really don't want to spoil this for people because it's such
Please
an
don't.
Interesting one. Yeah, it's Highly recommended, though, and they do a really interesting sort of spin on how you, the resolution of a zombie sort of apocalypse, a relation, how you would fundamentally go about creating a relationship between a zombie and a human.
Yeah,
as we said with, you know, Shaun of the Dead,
yes,
it's sort of another approach to the relationship between zombie and human,
or which we didn't even talk about, Fido. That movie is all about the relationship between zombies.
So
and
it's human. It's a really interesting approach to that, and just sort of like what life in a zombie apocalypse sort of world would be, a la, you know, Walking Dead or Zombieland or something like that. So definitely
very cool,
very good one. Definitely recommend checking out. It's by Jonathan Levine is the director, who did The Wackness, if you remember that movie.
Oh, uh-huh.
He also did 50-50 with Joseph Gordon-Levitt, so he's on kind of a nice little roll.
Nice.
There. And yeah,
it looks really, really interesting. The trailers for it definitely
I was sort of like a mixed opinion going into it. I thought the trailers were kind of interesting, but I was very pleasantly surprised.
That's good, because I think it's one of those things that from the trailer, from the inception of the idea, you're like, this could go really, really bad,
I was
it could go really, really
I was
good.
Very skeptical of the idea, so I'll admit
that. And we always know when you're skeptical.
I'm skeptical. Yeah. So, again, join us for our next episode, our DVD rundown for the week of February 5th.
Yes.
We're moving into February now.
Remember the 5th of February?
We'll go with it. I like it.
I'm not a good rhymer.
It's good. It's good enough. It's good enough for the MacGuffin.
I have no rhyme or reason.
Oh, snap. And as always, you can find us at MacGuffinPodcast.com, Twitter.com/MacGuffinCast, Facebook.com/MacGuffinPodcast, phone number 323-761-9842. We're on iTunes, Blip.tv, Miro, Roku.
Check in a Igloo. Get some sticky zombie badges.
Yeah, let's hope they have them. That'd be very appropriate.
Some
for
brains.
Us. Brains. And we'll see you next time.
Unless the zombies get us. The Wrath of Khan can't stop me, I'm on fire tonight. The board can't stop me. Because I've got space game and it feels alright.